Researchers have developed a new photonic chip that uses light for computing. I've talked about many photonic chips on this channel, but this optical chip is something different. Today, I will explain how it actually works and how did they manage to achieve this 1000x performance. Let me shine some light on it. When I think about light, the first thing that comes to my mind is a warm yellow sunlight. And what is color? Color is a wavelength of an electromagnetic wave. Now, some of these waves we can see, but most of them we can't. But the essence of light is photons, these little packets of energy. The main difference between photonic and electronic computer chips is that in photonic we use light instead of electrons for computation. And as we will understand later on in the video, the main difference is that in photonics we can compute the data on the fly. We don't have to stop the data like we do it in classical computing. We actually process the data while it's traveling. And this computation on the fly is in the range of femtoseconds, which is 1/4 of a second. So it's very fast and also at almost no latency. You know, when we switched from vacuum tubes to transistors, we went from microseconds to now nanoseconds. But photonic computing allows us to reduce it to femtoseconds. Let's understand how researchers came up with this idea. And for that, let's go back in time. The first revolution in photonic computing was the development of the laser. The laser is a device that turns random, unfocused photons into a powerful focused beam. It was invented over 60 years ago, and Charles Townes, who is considered to be a father of photonics, got a Nobel Prize for it. But back then, there were no real applications for the laser, while nowadays we use it pretty much every day, several times, starting from printers and scanners to quantum computers and extreme ultraviolet lithography machines that are used to fabricate every single silicon chip today. You know, modern chips like AMD CPUs or NVIDIA GPUs would simply not be possible without these machines and without the laser. Just think about the laser quest. This is surely worth a Nobel Prize, don't you think? After the laser, the second huge milestone in photonics was the development of optical fiber for communication. It was first developed by Charles Kunkao, who was also later awarded the Nobel Prize in Physics for his contributions. He engineered a special quartz glass material, and it was transparent enough so that photons couldn't be sent over huge distances, hundreds and hundreds of kilometers. And information travels at the speed of light through the optical fiber. And there is nothing faster than that in the world. And then they took it to the next level, and they managed to send multiple signals at the same time through this same fiber. And this was possible due to this beautiful property of light, that it has different colors or different wavelength of light that don't interfere with each other. So we can send a great amount of information simultaneously. And this, of course, also applies to computing. So the next huge milestone in photonics was the development of silicon photonics, because at this point we've already achieved and learned a lot with silicon. We've learned how to manufacture silicon chips on a massive scale. And then there was this idea to take all we know about semiconductor design and manufacturing and integrate silicon with photonics and use photons not just for data transmission, but for the computing itself. Because in this way, we can take advantage of this massive parallelism and the speed of light. That's a brilliant idea, right? And of course, a part of this, a very promising field of photonic quantum computing had begun evolving, which enables the dream of quantum computing at room temperatures. Let me know in the comments if you want me to make a separate episode about it, and make sure to subscribe to the channel not to miss it. Now, how does this Taichi chip work? It's a photonic chiplet, so it consists of several chips with different functionalities combined in a single package. If we consider all the photonic chips, there are two main approaches to building them. It usually uses either light diffraction or light interference for computing. However, this chip takes it one step further and combines both of these approaches in a very interesting way. Let's start with light interference, of course, after the great success of me talking about light interference in the previous video. I probably should continue to ride this wave. Jokes aside, I hope you have forgiven me. Anyway, many people inferred what I was referring to. As you know, light is a wave, and waves can interact, interfere, or overlap. If we go to the basic level, if I have two sinusoids that are in the same phase, the resulting wave will be twice the amplitude, and we will be able to better notice it because it will be just brighter. However, when I take two sinusoids that have been phase shifted 180 degrees, we have a phenomenon called destructive interference. And in this case, these two waves cancel each other out. And this leads to a drop in light intensity, or it can even lead to a total darkness. Many photonic chips nowadays implement this principle of light interference to implement linear operations. So, how does it work? Or simply put, how we can implement simple logic operations with light? Logic operations on a chip usually implemented with logic gates, which are these tiny switches. In electronics, these are built of transistors. And a typical electronic circuit consists of billions of switches that iterate between on and off states. And each of these gates has a logical operation behind them. If we take an AND logic gate, for example, depending on the combination of the input values, we get an output as a result. For example, when both inputs are 1s, so 1 and 1, we get 1 at the output. When the inputs are 1 and 0, 0 and 1, or 0 and 0, the output is 0. In electronics, all these zeros and ones are represented by voltages, by voltage level. So if the voltage is above certain value, a certain threshold, it's 1. Below, it's 0. And in photonics, it works in a similar way. But instead of voltages, we have light intensity. So we measure this light intensity at the output. And if it's above a certain value, then it's 1. Otherwise, it's 0.
This thing here is a logic AND gate. It has two inputs and one output. The first thing that we do is here, we use interference in this optical combiner, and we make sure that we have a strong field only when both of the inputs are on. And then the next stage that we have here is this microring, and this microring allows us to make a strong distinction between the on and the off level, so that the next gates, which listen to this gate, can understand the signal.
And before we discuss how we can use diffraction for computing with light, I guess you can imagine how much research goes into a video like this one. It usually takes me tens of hours over multiple days. And of course, I do a lot of fact-checking and reading beforehand. For this, I like using Opera browser because it has some very cool built-in AI features. First of all, there is their AI Aria. With this, you can actually get answers to your questions directly in your Opera sidebar. I really like this feature because it speeds up my research process a lot. Whenever I read something online and I encounter a term or concept that is not familiar to me, I can highlight it and Aria will give me a quick explanation, which I find very handy. And then, after a few hours, I have so many tabs open, and at some point I'm just lost. But Opera Browser has tab islands to deal with it. I use it to rearrange tabs into separate islands on related topic. For example, all the tabs related to photonic computing are grouped in the first island. Then all the research papers I'm using are grouped in the second island. And all the resources related to the diffraction of light are in the third. I highly recommend you to give it a try. You can download Opera for free using the link below. Check it out. Back to photons. There is a second, very interesting way, a very interesting approach to computing with light, using light diffraction. Let's say we have a light wave that moves. through an opening. And as a light passes through, it gets diffracted. We can see it as the bending of light when it moves through this opening. It's easier to imagine if you consider water waves being diffracted. Photonic diffraction is basically light waves bending around the obstacles. And guess what? It can be also used for performing logical operations. Let's say we encode input information into the amplitude of the light. And then it goes from the input layer through the diffraction layer to the output. Each region of this diffraction layer is a special meta surface, which is assigned with a particular logic operation. For example, here we have an OR logic gate, where we have 1 and 0 at the input, which gives us 1 as the output. It's complicated, yes. But it works. But the main drawback of this approach are that these operations are hard-coded into this surface, and it can't be reconfigured. Why this work is so interesting? Because they decided to take the best of both methods, light interference and light diffraction, and combine it in a single Taichi chip. First, we need to encode input data into light. And usually this encoding step is a weak spot in photonic computing, because this conversion from digital to analog, so from digital to light, is error prone, and it's very hard to make it as accurate as digital signal processing. But in this case, they used light diffraction on a chip to encode information into optical patterns. And because it's a fixed algorithm, they can implement it through diffraction, by using diffraction surfaces. So what happens is that just the light passing through the diffraction layers, and it's been encoded on the fly at almost no energy and in a massive parallel way. So this is as good as it gets. Then for the computing part, they use light interference. You know, when we talk about any AI-related computation, we mostly mean the operation with matrices. There is also another nonlinear part, which is the activation function, and you can't ignore it as well. But the most of the operations are operations with matrices. In neural networks, everything is represented by matrices. For example, if we want to do image recognition to know what's on it, we need to multiply matrices together and sum up the result. For this chip to implement this multiply accumulate operation with photonics, they first encode the input information into the amplitude of light. And then this light passes through so-called Mach-Zehnder interferometer. And as you may guess from the name, this device operates based on the light interference. This device splits light into two paths, then rejoin and split again. And you can alter the light that passes through one of these paths to multiply the light with a certain value. So we multiply the input matrix through these MZI cells with the weight, and then sum it up with the optical attenuator. And finally, we decode the result through the diffraction layer. And the most interesting thing here is that classical computers operate in serial fashion, means one operation being performed after another one. And in this case, to perform many operations in parallel, we need to have many GPUs, for example, to compute in parallel. But when it comes to photonic computing, by its nature, it can perform many operations in parallel, because we can compute at multiple wavelengths of light at the same time, and that's brilliant. Now, what differentiates this chip from photonic chips that we discussed in the past? First of all, it can perform more advanced computing tasks. If we take AI application as an example, previous optical chips were able to handle hundreds of thousands of parameters, while this new Taichi chip can handle up to 14 million parameters. This means it can perform much more advanced tasks when it comes, for example, to image classification. They've tested the chip with the dataset, which contains thousands of different handwritten characters from 50 different alphabets. And this chip was able to perform image classification with 92% accuracy. which is great for a photonic chip because it's analog. And one of the main problems with analog is exactly the accuracy. For example, not that long ago, I was reading a research paper about the light matter chip. And as far as I remember, the accuracy was back then about 80%. And you see, in this work, they achieved already 92%. Moreover, researchers tested this Taichi chip on generative AI tasks. And this is very interesting because you can really see that this photonic stuff actually works. This chip can produce music in the style of German composer Bach. And it can already draw, or more accurately to say, generate landscapes in the styles of Vincent van Gogh and Edvard Munch, who is well known for his famous painting, The Scream. And while this chip was performing these operations, they've measured it and is capable of 163 trillion operations per second per watt. And if we look at the performance comparison from the paper, it's reportedly more than 1,000 times more energy efficient than any of the latest NVIDIA H100 GPUs. And then, when they compared it to the previous research, it turned out to be roughly 100 times more energy efficient and 10 times more area efficient than previous photonic chips. And you know, area is one of the biggest problems when it comes to photonics. You know, while this chip itself is quite compact, the entire system is not, because they have used a laser source, right? And this can be the size of the whole table. And I don't know which exactly laser they used, but in general, it can consume up to 1 kilowatt. And this crushes all the efficiency gains we've just discussed. You know, all these optical components in general are quite bulky. For example, this MZI cell we discussed is about 50 micrometer dimensions. So it's huge when we compare it to the world of the semiconductor chips, where we have transistors in the range of nanometers. And quite some chip logic can fit on the area of a single photonic device. And of course, many fabs and many researchers are working on the further miniaturization of photonic components, but it's still nowhere near the conventional computer chips. However, as we saw earlier, this ability to perform multiple calculations at the different wavelengths of light is a great alternative way to scale the computing without just scaling the number of components. So it can compensate for that. All in all, it's a great work. First of all, they've built a chiplet that can run neural network with millions of parameters. And from the paper, I can see that they have an idea how to scale this chip further. And yes, it's clear that it's just for inference application right now, and it won't be in your computer at home tomorrow, but it's a building block to create the next generation of technology. If you've ever enjoyed my videos, please share it with your friends and colleagues and on social media. This helps the channel to grow a lot. Now check out my previous video, which many of you enjoyed a lot, where I explain how we can scale transistors beyond 1 nanometer using quantum interference. Thank you so much for your support, guys. Ciao.